transformational ideas to expand your corporate enterprise, push your sales, improve your market share, and grow your bottom line. But the challenge is how. In the complexity of today's fast-paced corporate environment, you will need many business applications to support these ideas, which of course are very expensive. Yet you still need to invest for that competitive advantage and to retain your customer. Each business requires a range of support infrastructure. We're talking about office space, power, air conditioning, data centers, high-speed bandwidth, networks, servers, storage space, complex software stacks, and a set of skilled technical experts who can manage all of it. It doesn't stop there. Constant upgrades, when they happen, need to be incorporated smoothly within your current system. And when there's a problem, you need quick and efficient troubleshooting to reduce that downtime. Multiply this into many core business applications that you need, and your costs will only spiral upwards. Cloud computing is the ideal answer to all of these issues and is highly effective in the way you could run your business. Instead of having to deal with the complexities, your company can draw on all of the infrastructure and software resources it needs via a shared data center as a service, just like a utility. Just log in and start using your service without having to worry about system crashes, viruses, and maintenance. The best part about business on the cloud is that you pay only for services based on usage, which is not a strain on your financial resources. The model is that simple. We at Sri Lanka Telecom have truly understood the benefits of transforming the way in which enterprises could run their business using cloud technology. In a bid to help you maximize the internal efficiencies of your business, we introduce to you the first ever national cloud platform, Arcasa. When you connect with Arcasa, you will be supported by the largest fiber optic network within the country and will have access to strong synergies, which differentiate us from most cloud service providers. Our locally hosted servers ensure steadfast reliability with guaranteed security of data and information, while our data centers are strategically positioned, ensuring minimal latency. An island-wide sales and support network remain on call to assist and troubleshoot around the clock. Let's look at the many ways in which Arcasa can strengthen your business. With infrastructure as a service, or IaaS, your business will no longer have to invest in expensive infrastructure. Instead, all you will have to do is host your data centers, servers, and storage space on the cloud. Based on your requirement, our infinite capacity will provide you with the infrastructure you will need on demand. For developers, we offer PaaS, or Platform as a Service, where they can draw on hosted platforms in the cloud to develop new applications and interact with other developers. SaaS, or Software as a Service, has a range of software applications for your business to choose from for requirements of any scale to be undertaken at any time, anywhere in the world. With DaaS, or Desktop as a Service, Arcasa takes over and manages the back-end responsibilities of your company's desktops, data storage, backup, security, and upgrades. Essentially, the core of your ICT system will be held in one secure location. CaaS, or Communication as a Service, allows businesses to selectively deploy communication services on a pay-as-you-go basis. This will eliminate the large capital investment and ongoing overhead for a system whose capacity may often exceed or fall short of current demand. The benefits that your business can derive from migrating to the Arcasa cloud platform are endless. With low cost, highly secure and scalable services that you can source on demand anytime and anywhere, your business can now focus on real value addition and better return on investment while we manage the complexities for you. Welcome to the first ever national cloud platform in Sri Lanka. Arcasa.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Tech Talk on Microservices Architecture, which is organized by the Slascom Technology Forum and Sri Lanka Telecom. Before we begin, I'd like to thank our three speakers, Mr. Afkam Aziz, Mr. Janaka Vikramasinghe, Mr. Ashan Fernando, for being here this evening to conduct this Tech Talk. So I'd like to begin by inviting Mr. Keithi Pereira, Chief Enterprise and Wholesale Officer, Sri Lanka Telecom, to do the welcome address.
Senior members of Slascom and Slascom Technology Forum, office bearers of Slascom, heads of development companies, developers, entrepreneurs, my dear colleagues in SLT, very good evening to you all. So thank you very much for being here with us today. I would like to thank both Slascom and Sri Lanka Telecom for giving me this opportunity to warmly welcome you all for Tech Talks on Microservices Architecture, which is a very important topic which we are talking today. In my organization, as you all know, our purpose is to use the power of communications to make a better place to do business and also live peacefully. We believe my organization exists in the market to meet the needs of our customers, communities, delivering the high quality experience, products, and services which are relevant to them. If we really and carefully look at the future markets, most importantly, to invest and collaborate for translating our investments to value creation and value delivery to the society. As cloud technology advances, we are continuously exploring ways to transform our business models as well. And not only we are transforming the technology, we are also transforming our business models to deal with customers, to work with customers, to engage with customers, as well as our partners around us in our ecosystem. So Slascom today is a classic example. There are trends to move towards network virtualization and virtual data centers. So virtualization is being discussed everywhere in the space of network and data centers, cloud. You all know that. So I'm happy to say that SLT was the first company in Sri Lanka to introduce virtualization in our data centers way back in 2004. We are working with industrial partners to create new solutions that will allow network services and data services to run faster and more efficiently in a virtual environment. So how we help our businesses to cut costs and emission is the next challenge. As you all know, we are very aggressively deploying our high-speed fiber network all over the country. And our fiber network is running down in each and every corner of this country along almost all the streets, and which is reaching your residences as well. So it is this high-speed fiber network that makes easier for our businesses to use cloud-based IT services. Like, you know, the services that we are talking in the infrastructure space, infrastructure as a services in the platform space, which is very useful for the forum here, for developers, and you can talk of desktop as a service, software as a service. In the application space, there are so many applications like email solutions, CRMs, ERP, industry-specific applications. So we can talk of so many things in this space. Then on top of that, storage, security. So all those services are offered now in the context of hosted environments and cloud environments. Doing things online based on pay as you use, grow as you use, instead of physical alternatives or a central IT system, help business to cut costs and also to reduce carbon emission. So if you really look at the investments for the future, we at SLT investing in improving our infrastructure and expertise. So if I mention few, we are building a tier 3 data center at Pitipana, Homagama, and which will be ready by end of January. So this is going to be a 500 rack data center, which is the largest in SLT and hopefully in the country, and in a separate premises. It is a dedicated data center premises. And also, we continuously invest on further expansions on our cloud Akasa platform, which we recently established. And we are investing to establish DR as a solution, and also other options on infrastructure and storage, applications, and most importantly, we are building the ecosystem in and around our cloud platform, Akasa, to make sure that the best propositions are offered to our valued customers. So today, developers as well as customers need less equipment, fewer engineering visits to start using services, and are able to work more effectively, which we expect will reduce their travel costs and emissions. We are extending our fiber broadband network and broadening our cloud portfolio, enabling more options so citizens in Sri Lanka can benefit from ultra broadband breakthrough cloud services. We have established our full-fledged cloud platform, which is of no difference with global platforms. You can name it, you know it. But certainly, which can deliver through your domestic bandwidth, where you don't need to pay for international bandwidth, number one. And also, you can access much faster because it is locally hosted by guaranteeing and ensuring the data security and integrity. Because we believe we are a trusted service provider who have served in this country over 150 years. I request all the stakeholders, particularly including the developer community in this country, to actively engage, participate, and be a proud member of our ecosystem. SLT's National Cloud, Akasa. Thank you very much.
I'd like to invite our first speaker, Mr. Akram Aziz, who is a Senior Director, Platform Architecture at WSO2, to talk on microservices theory.
So I'm here to talk about microservices architecture. One of the things that I get to talk about is hype words. So microservices is the latest hype word. So like those of us in the industry know that our industry, from time to time, we come up with many hype words. So for some reason, I get to talk about these things. So I spoke about MBAS, mobile platform as a service, some time back. IPaaS, integration PaaS as a service. So like you'll hear about so many star as, right? So this is the latest trend. So I'm here to talk about that. So if you are wondering what's the relevance of this picture to my topic, there's no relevance. This is actually a beautiful picture from Uddavalave Park, right? So those of us in the industry need to you know, go out and get some fresh air because, you know, we are always on our machines. So I'll just go into the definition. So like if you look at many of the terms in our industry, again, there is no standard definition, no globally acceptable definition. If you ask anybody what an ESB is, they will give you 10 different definitions. There will be disagreements and so on. A method of developing software applications as a suite of independently deployable small modular services which, in which each service runs a unique process. So just pay attention to these words in red, keywords, independently deployable. So microservice should be independently deployable, small, an ambiguous term. We'll see what that means. Modular, unique process, communicates through well-defined lightweight mechanisms. So that's one of the definitions out there. So the whole idea is like when it comes to what's known as a monolithic application, like you have these three-tier applications and so on, right? So the idea is basically like rather than having all of your code running on a single node, basically you break it up. So if you look at this side of the picture, the left side of this slide, you see that so you see that, so this is one instance. So the small, you know, this colorful stuff that you see is basically software components running within a single instance. So if you want to vertically scale your system, or sorry, if you want to horizontally scale your system, you basically create more instances of this particular image, right? So one of the issues with this strategy is you might like unnecessarily scale up stuff that you don't need. For example, let's say this is the user management component, and your user management component, the blue color one is the user management component, but your user management component is not seeing as many, you know, it's not seeing much load compared to other bits of your application, right? But if you have your application packaged like this, you have to scale up the bits even that, the bits that you don't need as well. So the problem there is like, unnecessarily you will be consuming resources, and then there are per instance based licenses, right? So you basically pay, an annual subscription or something like that based on the number of instances you run. So if you scale up systems like that, you have to unnecessarily pay for those bits as well. So the idea is basically rather than have a single monolithic application, now you break it up. It's a core component. So you can see we have broken it up into three or four different components. And then you basically scale up only those bits. So if you're, let's say you have a store, you have a storefront, right? So you have a storefront that is which is receiving more load. You basically look at the load that's coming into that application and then and you scale up only that bits. So if you might have a backing ORM layer, you might have different services that are required by that particular store. You might have your authentication, your identity management system. So you need not scale up those things. You just scale up your storefront. So that's basically the idea behind, a very high level idea behind microservices. Microservices architecture known as MSA. So let's look at some characteristics of microservices. Small. So we looked at this term earlier. So a microservice. So micro. When you say micro, you basically think about something small. So what? How small? So that's something that nobody will be able to give a definite answer to you. So users like people have been giving different opinions. So in Amazon. In some companies, they say your team should be a two pizza team. How many of you have heard about two pizza teams? Right, so you should be able to feed your entire team with two pizzas. So actually this makes sense, like most of us who have to work overnight and stuff like that, you know, we order pizza, right? So two pizza team. So that's basically like 7 to 9 people. Then the other thing they say is, okay, it should have, you know, this many lines of code. That's another sort of ambiguous definition. But in Amazon, what they do is they say, like, you build it, you run it. So you need, you have a team which can build the stuff, and they have to run it as well. So normally what happens is, when you build your software bits, right, you build it and you do a release, and it's when you run it in production, somebody else takes over running that bit in production. But here the idea is, you have a single team which builds it and which runs it. And to do that, that such a team can't be an extremely large team, right? Such a team should be able to sort of have a well-defined scope. So they have a well-defined business function. They build a service a service or a couple of services which caters to that function. They build it and they run it. So another good thing about that is, you know the pain points related to your software. So then, like, when you get woken up in the middle of the night due to a bug, you might not have checked for a null pointer, right? You didn't do a null check, and there is a bug. You get woken up. Next time, you will be much more careful. So you have a team which is running and building and running the system. The other important aspect is, it's organized around business capabilities. So rather than, you know, having a DB admin team, a database team, a middleware team, and then a UI experts team, you have a team which is a multidisciplinary team, right? So there is something called Conway's Law. How many of you have heard of Conway's Law? So what Conway's Law says is, right, when you have your design of your system basically will reflect the communication structure. So let's say you have now structured your team as the DB admins, you have the middleware layer, and you have the UI guys. So rather than, you know, communicating across boundaries, for the people who are familiar with the database stuff, they have control over there. It's, you know, rather than put some logic, let's say, in the business logic layer, it might be easier for them to put it as a stored procedure or something. And then you can do a lot of stuff on the UI layer, using maybe JavaScript libraries and stuff like that. So they say, okay, don't organize your team like that. Organize your team around business capabilities. So you basically break up your application by identifying the business capabilities, and then you have a multidisciplinary team. So you have UI personnel, you have database experts, you have DevOps personnel, you have integration experts on your team. So they work as a single team, and they are responsible of building and running this particular piece of software or this particular service. And then componentization is via services, right? So one level of componentization is via libraries. So you can take dependencies on libraries and build one binary, and that will be your deliverable. The other aspect is to basically break it into multiple services and then treat those services as deliverables. And those deliverables will have independent release cycles. So you have well-defined APIs, right? So you don't break APIs so that your consumers are not affected, but you can evolve and do new releases of your system. So you don't have to do one big bang release of the entire application. As and when necessary, if there are security vulnerabilities, you identify, okay, these particular services are vulnerable, you roll out a new release, right? Rather than having to do a full release. So the most important thing is, you need explicit component interfaces for communication, and you need to maintain those APIs so that you don't break your system. Decentralized data management. So rather than having a monolithic application which is talking to a single database, rather than a monolithic application talking to a single database where you have multiple tables and stuff like that, you basically break it up into multiple applications or multiple services which have their own data storage. The data storage technology can be different. So one particular service might be using a NoSQL database, while another service might be using an RDBMS, file data store, Hadoop-based file system, something like this. Whatever that is appropriate for that particular service can be used. So one of the issues you might think face is, okay, you'll have data normalization problems. It will have to duplicate data. So that's one of the challenges. So the way to deal with that is either you have to be able to live with eventually consistent guarantees, or you have to do some out of band synchronization mechanism, or you have to have transactions, but the transaction approach is not recommended because it's going to cause other performance overheads and other complications. So support for technology heterogeneity, right? So the idea is, when it comes to multiple services, you can use the most appropriate technology for that particular service, rather than having to stick with a chosen technology. So for example, for one particular application, you might decide to go with Node.js or Golang. And for another thing, you might decide to go with Java, right? So you use the most appropriate technology for your service. The thing is, the others are not dependent on the technology that you are using, right? So because you have well-defined component interfaces. That's the whole idea behind microservices. Design for failure. So again, now earlier your system was like, if you think of a monolithic system, everything was living in a single runtime, right? So you didn't have to think about this component failing. So you have a registry which is talking to a user management component. If they are in the same runtime, the call is within the same process. So you don't have to think about failures. But when it comes to the microservices world, you have to think about these failures. But this is a best practice when it comes to communicating with any external system. But now the communications are much more frequent. So you have to think about how to handle failures. So there are a number of patterns. So bulkhead is one of those patterns. So in the ship bulkhead, what happens is, if one area gets flooded, it's basically restricted to that area. That particular failure will not propagate beyond that particular compartment. So you have bulkheads. So in software also, we have the bulkhead pattern, which is frequently used when it comes to microservices. So you don't let your failures cascade. So you have one service, it fails, and then there are other services that are depending on these services. If those also start failing, your entire application is going to crash. You need to have some sort of contingency built in, right? You don't let the failures propagate. And then there is another pattern called the circuit breaker pattern. So when you're talking, when two different services are communicating, one service might become slow or might start throwing errors. So at that point, rather than keeping on sending requests to that particular service, you implement what is known as a circuit breaker. So after a certain number of failures, you basically trip the circuit. And then what happens is, request will not be sent to that particular service. So at that particular time, you need to have some contingency measure in this consumer. So what you could do is, you could use maybe cached values. You might talk to a different failover endpoint, or you might serve them some historical data. So it depends on your application. And then subsequently, the circuit goes into what's known as the half open state. In the half open state, what does this? So this is a timer. So after a certain time period, you again, when a request comes in, which has to be routed to a second service, you send the request over and check whether that is succeeding. If that succeeds, then you close the circuit. So then you can keep on sending requests to the second service. But if it fails, again, you go back to the open state. So this is basically like the operation of a typical circuit breaker. So the circuit breaker pattern is another pattern. So there are a bunch of patterns when it comes to microservices, like timeout, bulkhead, circuit breaker. So just do some Google search and you'll be able to find a lot of information. disposable. So your services, so now your services are independent and you're communicating through well-defined interfaces. So you could discard, so if you find a particular error or some problem in a service, you could basically discard those service instances and start other instances. Or you could do even a new deployment, a completely new version. You could roll out a completely new version. So the idea here is there is this cattle versus pets analogy. So that's what this slide is about. So the thing is, like, if you look at the traditional deployments, we always think about servers like pets, right? Pets. So when you have pets, what do? You basically give them names. Then you, if they are sick, you take them to the vet. You nurse them back to health, right? So you are very concerned about the health of that particular pet. Right, because you don't want that pet to die, right? But if when it comes to cattle, if the cattle has some sort of critical sickness and all that, you basically discard of the cattle. You don't think about nursing it back to health and all that, because these are very easily replaceable. So rather than thinking about servers in the traditional sense like pets, right, where you keep constant monitoring on, and if the server crashes, somebody is woken up, and there's a big issue. Now the world is moving towards this model, where if something dies, you basically spawn a new instance, rather than worrying about that and keeping that running. So one of the issues that one of the nightmares is memory leaks, right? If there are memory leaks and your server crashes, it's going to be a big issue. But moving towards this new system, so there's a talk on containers and Docker and Kubernetes and stuff like that. So we are moving towards a world where we don't worry about these things much. So we don't want to keep servers running indefinitely for months and years and so on, right? So like typically we would launch containers, use them for the purpose, and then discard them. So we are moving towards a different paradigm. So most of these things, right? It sounds like you have heard it before, right? So most of these concepts, we have heard of these things. These are like software design best practices, encapsulation, maintaining the contract. So this is like the stuff that you have heard. So what's new about microservices? So isn't this just SOA? Right? Even though there is a major hype about microservices these days, if you think about it, and if you, like, even like 10 years back, if you did SOA correctly, you might say, what's the big deal? Right? This is how we have been designing software systems throughout. We have been having services which are based on the business capabilities rather than the function. And we don't package stuff as huge monolithic apps. We break them up like this. So that's actually quite true. Martin Fowler. How many of you have heard of Martin Fowler? So go to martinfowler.com and read his articles, right? It's essential reading for architects and even like developers. So Martin Fowler is a guy who actually writes a lot about software architectural patterns, software architecture best practices. So he did a keynote on microservices, and he says, okay, if you are doing SOA correctly, microservices is, of course, not a big deal. But there are some differentiating factors that we will take a look at during the rest of this presentation. So coming back to MSA. So this is the definition that I originally put up. So just to recap, independently deployable, small modular services, unique processes, communicates through well-defined lightweight mechanisms to serve a business goal. So let's analyze each of these points. So this is the slide I lost. So if you look at the characteristics summarized, so look at this, the left side of the presentation. Small, running in its own process, communication via often via HTTP or other lightweight mechanisms built around business capabilities, written in different programming languages using different data storage mechanisms, and independent deployable by fully automated deployment machinery. So these are some of the key characteristics of microservices summarized. If you look at the first point, small, it's an ambiguous term. So it doesn't mean that you just have need to have just a couple of thousand lines of code or something like that. It's basically something about the scope, right? So that's again a software development best practice, right? So even when it comes to a class, you don't write a class that's 2,000 lines long. You have to modularize. So even when it comes to systems, you have to modularize. So you have to keep it manageable, right? So that's a best practice. So we don't see anything new there. Running in its own processes, right? So that's true for many services. This is nothing different from SOA. Communication often via HTTP and other lightweight messaging protocols. Again, true for many services. Built around business capabilities, written in different programming languages, using different data storage techniques. That's the definition of services. So the concept of services has been there for, 25 years. So the concept of services has been there. So there's nothing new here. The interesting thing is independently deployable by fully automated deployment machinery. So that's something that's novel in this world, right? So microservices goes hand in hand with the deployment aspect, right? So one of the things that we always hear about developers is, when there is a bug, they say it works on my machine, right? So very frequently what we say is, we basically say, muge muvat machine ekat ekkama ship karanna ona, right? So you have to ship that guy's machine along with the code. So that used to be a joke, but now it has become reality. How many of you have heard about containers? So the main reason why things work on your machine and it doesn't work on somebody else's machine is something is different, right? Either the memory you have allocated is different, or the configurations are different. Your JVM, if you're running Java, your JVM minor version is different, right? So it works on your machine, doesn't work on somebody else's machine. So the solution is ship the machine as well, along with the software. So that's where the world is moving towards. And this is going hand in hand with the microservices world. So you basically are entering the container world. So this is what I see as a major shift in the paradigms of our industry. Like most companies have now started they are shipping their software in containers. So I was trying out a cloud service recently. And then they have a CLI tool for their cloud service. So for their CLI tool, they are basically giving a Docker, they are giving a Docker image. So you just have to say Docker run dash IT and the image ID, and it launches the CLI tool. So you don't have to install anything on your particular machine. So I won't go into the details because the next session is going to be a very interesting session on Docker and Kubernetes and stuff like that. Docker is a mechanism to package your entire system. So you have your running software, your configuration files, whatever the other processes that you need, everything packaged into a single container, and then that's a deliverable, right? And then you have multiple containers running your services. And then you have now, rather than having a simple system where you had your monolith and you created instances of that monolith, now you have a large number of containers running which are running these components or the microservices. So to manage such a system, you need a container cluster manager. You have multiple solutions out there for that. So we have Kubernetes, we have Docker Swarm, we have Mesos, so we have a bunch of alternatives out there. So just a bit about containers. How many of you haven't heard about containers? You guys have heard about VMs, right? So you guys have used VMware, you have used EC2 instances, right? All of those are VMs. Those are full operating systems. So a container is not a full operating system. A container basically, so this is, you can see this is a VM. It's running on a hypervisor. It has a guest OS. And then you have your app and the libraries and stuff like that. So this is a VM running on top of a hypervisor on a host operating system. In Docker, it's different. So you have a Docker engine. So typically, it runs as a daemon. And then this is your particular container, your app and your libraries, your config files running on top of that. So it basically uses the underlying kernel of the operating system. So there isn't a full operating system running on top of this. So that is very interesting because now you can run, you can run many more containers than the number of VMs you can run on a physical machine. So it provides some level of isolation. So there is no 100% isolation. So there are security issues. So like if two containers are running, so it is an isolated environment, but it is not. It doesn't provide as much isolation as a VM, right? But you can spawn as many containers as you need. You can kill them. You can have multiple machines running containers, and you can have a cluster. And then you need a container cluster manager. So does MSA really reduce complexity? MSA, like in my opinion, MSA doesn't reduce the complexity. It actually increases the complexity. But in the long run, you will start seeing the benefits, right? So to get your MSA right, or get your initial deployment, you might have to put in more effort. But you will see the benefits in the long run, because now you have your services which are independently deployable, and you can upgrade your different parts of your system independently. Different teams can work in a very effective manner. So there are a large number of benefits. So this is a way in which you operate. So you could have done SOA like this, right? But people are talking about these aspects related to development of microservices architectures. So this is from one of the Gartner research articles. When it comes to a microservice architecture, there is something known as the inner architecture and the outer architecture. So the bits in the middle. So these bits in the middle, that's the inner architecture. So as you can see, we have microservice A, B, C, D, a bunch of microservices. So each of these microservices can be running its own technology, having its own data storage and stuff like that. And then they communicate with each other. But you can see there are more complicated bits in what is known as the outer architecture. So now these you have multiple services. Now these services need to be able to discover each other, right? So you need a discovery mechanism. You need some sort of service discovery mechanism. You need a service registry. And then you should be able to route requests from one service to the other. So you need service routing. You need a service gateway to expose your functionality to the outside world. So you typically have an API management solution or an API gateway there to expose your services. So here you have your, so the outside world will not actually see your microservices. They will see this as a single system. So you expose well-defined APIs to the outside world. So there can be clients running on the cloud, mobile apps, other machines. So you have well-defined APIs there. Dependency management between these services, shared configuration, and then for messaging, you might have HTTP messaging channels or other lightweight queuing channels. And then like you need to have some diagnostics, monitoring, alerting. So you could basically like do something like you have microservice A, B, and C. You need to say there should be at any given time three instances, three containers of microservice A running. But if something goes wrong, right, there should be automated mechanisms to monitor the health and restart that instance or kill that instance and start a new instance. So those complexities come in. So like tools like Kubernetes are actually trying to solve that kind of problem, health monitoring. So these are bits that you have to think about. So the complexity is now mainly moved to the outer architecture. So as there's no silver bullet. So coming to the final part of my presentation, I'll just talk about a project that I've been working on recently at WSO2. So this is a microservices framework for Java. So if you want now, so those of you who have heard about microservices for the first time, you might actually want to do something hands-on and try some stuff out. So there are a bunch of frameworks out there. There's a framework called Spring Boot. You have Drop Wizard. You have MSF4j. A bunch of frameworks out there. So the important thing about the framework that you're going to choose is it should be container friendly. So microservices go hand in hand with this container, the container concept, right? So when it came to MSF4j, these are our key design goals to make it container friendly. Very low memory footprint, low latency, high throughput, small pack size. So for a base, you know, very basic service, when we ran our benchmark test, we could actually like just allocate 7 MB of heap memory to the JVM, and then hit it with 50 concurrent requests indefinitely without the server running out of memory. So that's one of our benchmark tests. And low latency is another important thing. So like you could you know, your throughput might be high, but then like your average mean latency might be low. And small pack size. So the distributable should be relatively small so that, you know, that's let's say you are creating a container and your container size is, you know, 5 GB or something like that. It doesn't make sense because in the container world, the whole idea is you should be able to quickly launch containers, launch as many containers as you need. But if you have huge binaries, you can't, like it basically defeats the purpose. So to be container friendly, your applications have to be relatively small, even the binary pack size, because you're packing that into your image. And so these are some graphs from some of our benchmarks. You can see the throughput. So I don't think you can read this stuff. So we have compared it with Spark, Spring Boot, Wildfly, Dropcar, Drop Wizard, and MSF4j. So in the throughput price, you can see we are right at the top. So because that like has been our design goal from day one. And then again, mean latency is again relatively low compared to the other frameworks. So if you are interested, you could go to github.com/wso2/msf4j. So just search for MSF4j. You should be able to find the GitHub project. So it's a completely community-driven project. Try it out. The interesting thing is we have a sample. So there are frameworks out there, but you don't see a full microservices architecture in action. So we have a sample called the PetStore sample. So those of you who are familiar with Java know that Java EE has this standard PetStore application. It's a monolithic application. So what we try to do is basically take that and break it up into multiple microservices and then have mechanisms like Docker Swarm, Docker Compose, Kubernetes, and you know, deploy this and create as many containers as necessary. So we have all the scripts and the code in that sample. So that's a bit of a complicated sample. So that shows all of these technologies coming together And you know, that should give you, if you are able to run that sample, you should be able to give you a good idea about these technologies. So key takeaways from my session. Microservices are all about proper granularity and independent deployment. It's not a counter proposal to SOA and doesn't mean SOA failed. So SOA is an architectural style, right? It's a concept. So nowadays you won't hear people talking about ESBs. ESBs are not hot anymore, but people are talking about gateways, right? API gateways, right? So rather than talking about ESBs, they're talking about gateways. So from time to time, different topics become hot in our industry. But the core concepts stay the same, right? Even when we are doing COBA, that was, you know, COBA was services, right? Conceptually, it's the same. So the concept of service has been there, and it is not going to die, right? So SOA hasn't failed, and MSA doesn't reduce complexity, as we saw. And coming up with the proper granularity is a challenge. So don't expect frameworks or other middleware vendors to solve your microservices architecture problem and give you a, you know, clean diagram saying this is, you know, just use these components and everything will be fine. You have to figure out your MSA, right? And it will be an evolutionary approach. So if you have a monolith, right, you can't actually discard everything and move to a microservices architecture. You have to, or if you are moving from SOA, so let's say you have traditional SOA with SOAP and web services, and you have, you know, rather than using containers, you're using VMs for deployment. So you can't just throw all that away and move, right? You have to have an evolutionary approach. So you look at components that can be made into microservices, and you move them, and gradually you, you know, you evolve your system into an MSA. So it's called, you know, the popular phrase is eating your monolith one bite at a time, right? Rather than building everything from scratch, throwing everything and building everything from scratch, you build it part by part, and it's an evolutionary process. So the final message from me is MSA is SOA done right. Plus modern deployment mechanisms. So that's the key attraction. So I think questions will be at the end of the session, right?
Thank you, Mr. Aziz. Next, I'd like to invite our second speaker, Mr. Janaka Vikramasinghe. He's a principal consultant, Ascension IT. He'll be talking on containerized infrastructure.
So I think the previous speaker gave a very good insight to microservices architecture and the theory around it. And actually now you can really see this. You can practice this at Akasa. So we brought Docker containers and Kubernetes to Akasa. So we can actually have a bit of a hands-on session as well. Right. OK, just to give a brief about me. I'm at the moment the principal consultant at Ascension IT. We are mainly into cloud middleware. It's a cloud service brokering solution which can connect to multiple cloud systems and bring on board different technologies like the microservices and all that. And I've also, in the same company, I've also created a PaaS platform. It's a public PaaS. At the moment, I'm also heading the insurance business unit at Informatics as a CTO. So here we are actually modernizing. They are about 12, 13 years old legacy co-insurance application. So what we are doing is just like the previous speaker said, we are biting one bite at a time, and we are creating the business value around microservices while keeping the core, legacy core, solid legacy core, and creating new business values using microservices. And also I've been working with open source in enterprise, mostly enterprises, giving them some strategies converting them into, you know, having their own open source strategies, like maybe starting from things like mail servers, the security side, and then slowly migrate into their core systems and all that. So, yeah. So I thought I'll just have a thought about the current landscape, how it has changed over the period of time, and you guys can hear, all right? Yeah. Okay. Cool. Right. So there's a whole lot of mobile software coming in, mobile applications and all that coming in. So the strategy is changing towards more mobile internet of things. You need to do a lot of real-time analysis. So the earlier traditional methods of developing software is you cannot keep up with the current business need. So you need to actually have a much more agile and faster time into the market. So I think in that case, you need to have smaller teams and having full stack developers or full much more diversified group of people in the teams, so that you can get that whole, you can basically give that business value to the customers. So from 2005 to now, the whole sort of development system has changed from the three tiers to many, many components integrated. So this is kind of the current application stack you would see. You have a bunch of front-end services talking to many multiple data storages, and then it might be talking, pumping the data into a real-time analytics, and you must be doing some machine learnings and things like that. So we actually did a similar design with one of the insurance companies, where they had like multiple sources where they could get different data. Like some of them would get like images. Some places they want to integrate with a VOIP system and all that. So the core system you cannot handle those. So we would develop small little bits and pieces to do those things, and then they will have their own sort of data store and all that, which again you can use it to do some certain analytics and things like that. So we could actually give, in that case, you can actually give not only a technological advantage, but also advantage in the industry. So they would get a way ahead with their competition as well. So, yeah. So some of the implications you would get while adapting these technologies, you cannot have a single vendor as previously would say, okay, one ERP, you have one particular vendor and supporting all across. That's not the case. You might have to do some more development, so you might have multiple vendors and all that. And like I said, the team strategy also should be different. And collaborative is becoming a key. And the delivery becomes much more difficult. So that's where these newer trends like the containerization and faster to delivery, and then if something fails, you just forget about it, you spin up a new one, just go on doing that, right? Okay, so just dump into the containers. So it's not really a new concept. So slowly it actually evolved over time, and the whole sharing concept happened in my mainframes back about 50 years ago, I guess. Yeah, no, not 50, no. About 40 years ago. And so initially also they had a physical as well as OS level partitioning with IBM's VM 370s. And slowly it came into the i380, the x86 architecture, and the VMware was one of the leading vendors. And so the whole, all of a sudden, the huge hypervisor boom happened in 2000s with ESX, the Xen, KVM, all that. And similarly, the containerization itself, the whole concept is actually quite been there for some time. Like if you guys know FreeBSD, they were having BSD jailing systems. Solaris had a zones, and even OpenVZ with Linux. That's another Linux project. And also they had user mode Linux and LXC and finally Docker. So what exactly is this container? So it's basically like, let's say you have a bunch of goods that you need to transport, right? So you'll have to, maybe you can't keep a, you know, like a, some spices next to oil or something. So you'll have to think about the mode of transportation. So the complexity becomes very difficult to manage. So what's the solution? You have a standard container. So in the container, you might have, you know, have an AC to certain, biological, some medicine or something, and then inside the AC you can do a lot of things, but when it comes to mode of transportation, it's just a box. So you can transport via ship, you can, you know, use a crane to move around it, or train to move around it as well. So it's the same concept with software as well. So you have so many challenges when it comes to deploying it. Like he said, like the my previous presenter said that, you know, it works in his laptop, right? So, but it doesn't work on the, maybe in the server. So there are so many permutations and combinations you get. So similarly, Docker gives a one whole solution that you can actually move around. You know, whatever works in your laptop, it actually can work in your, in the data center as well. Right, okay, coming to Docker. So Docker, there are a couple of main components in Docker. One is the engine, composer, registry, machine, and swarm. So the engine is the core. Engine is actually one particular service. It's a daemon running in the middle. I'll show you how it actually works. And then there's a bunch of API layer. So basically you can have a client, CLI, or some other method to talk into it, and then do some things like scheduling, creating images, getting information about the data, network information, and all that. So when you do a deployment, you basically have a registry. You keep a registry where you keep all these Docker images, and then you pull it and then deploy it. So that's this right-hand side diagram is about. So how it actually works, right? Docker is not a lot of magic. It's actually using a lot of kernel's features. So I think after 3.10 kernel, you have isolation mechanism in place. So what it does is it actually creates a namespace. So in that namespace, all the processors, all the mount points, network, users, all that is isolated from another namespace. So we call it C groups. And so that's basically what it uses. Like LXC also use the same thing. So what actually Docker has done now, they have earlier they would use a middle layer, like a LXC or Libert or whatever, to talk to the Linux namespace and all that. Now they have actually brought a new library called lib container because it directly talked to Linux, and also very recently I think they have released a Windows version also. So you can run Windows Nano on Docker as well now. So that will talk to the Windows similar isolation mechanism in the Windows kernel system as well. So that's how it works. And the other part of it is that it's actually using a copy-on-write file system. So that means, let's say you start building a one base layer, and on top of that, you can build another base layer, and on top of that, you can build another one. So that actually help you to save up a lot of time and space. And Docker Compose is basically, let's say you can't just run a one Docker container. Let's say you need a database, you need to have a front end, you have a back end, right? So no point of running these two separately. You have to run it, I mean, it makes sense if you run it together. So that is where this Docker Composer comes into place. So it basically helps you to run multi-container Docker applications. And also you can mention about the volumes and different other variables as well. And generally this is used in dev environments and also for automated testing and all that. But now there's a tendency to get this into the production as well. By the way, Docker is like continuously growing and all that, so they are coming up with some good strategies. And up until Docker 1.12 version, they had this orchestration system. Now, once you have all these Docker containers, you need to orchestrate. You need to make sure, you know, there's a high requirement to have one particular service. So you need to have multiple Docker containers scaling horizontally. So that sort of scheduling and monitoring, health monitoring, all that was done in something called Docker Swarm. And now it is built into the engine. So you have a Swarm mode. So it does a full cluster management orchestration of the Docker engine. And the basic concept is you have a manager node, and then you have multiple slave nodes or worker nodes. So from the manager node, it can actually dictate, you know, you guys need to run these services and all that. And so it actually provides a load balancing as well. So say for example, it creates its own overlay network. So let's say you have three nodes, and you have one particular Docker container which is having something running on port 80. And once you open it up, all these three nodes, wherever you call for port 80, it will automatically load balanced and direct to the correct one, even though it's not running in that particular node. So it creates that overlay network and manages the load balancing part as well properly. That's where this, you can basically, there's a concept called publish port, and then you can basically bind whatever the port that you are going to run on publish port. This is the internal load balancer. You might want to have a external cloud load balancer as well, talking to those ports. Okie dokie, let's have a demo. Right, so let's start with create a WordPress application. So if you want to create a WordPress application, you need to have a MySQL database, and then you need to have the WordPress application, WordPress software as well. So first thing is you need to create the MySQL doc container. So simple one, docker run name, just give a name for the database, and then the password for the MySQL root password, and then minus d means like it goes to the background, and start MySQL, right? So then it starts a MySQL container. So if you look at grep MySQL. Yeah, so it's actually running it here, MySQL. So let's say, what it does is actually it basically creates, like I said, it creates that isolated environment where it have its own namespace. So you can actually see it at sysfs, C groups, let's say CPU, and then you have Docker, and then this particular ID, it created a group there. And then if you look at the tasks, those are the PIDs or the processors that are in that group. So it's all in that namespace. So that you have an isolation so that the other Docker containers cannot directly mangle with this container, right? Okay, so let's just create the WordPress instance as well. So Okay, so what we do is like we get the WordPress Docker image and then link that one up with MySQL. So there are a bunch of parameters that you can link up. You can create volumes, persistent volumes, and things like that. So this will basically create a MySQL and a WordPress instance. So if you do a Docker PS, so these are the two things that it had created, right? Now it's actually listening to port 8080. I have mentioned here to, I have asked it to listen to port 8080 and forward the internal port, forward it to internal port 80. So now if we go to localhost and 8080, you should see, you should basically, now you can basically start deploying WordPress, right? So this, I did it in my machine. Now you can actually do it in Akasa. So we have actually, I'll show you how we have done it in a later session. Okay, so we have created, so basically we have created one master and two nodes at Akasa, right? So we're going to use the Docker Swarm to do this whole orchestration. So let's see, first Docker, oops. Okay, right. So so what I did was I basically created a very simple Spring Boot microservice application and just say like hello world. Right, and just the code, if you were to look at it. Yeah, so here, this is the application. Yeah, so just have a hello controller that will say, okay, if you say slash, say hello, it will say hello and the version. So this basically we built it, and then we created a Docker. We basically Dockerized this particular application, right? So to Dockerize, you need to build that application and create a Docker file, and then you can mention how you want to build that application. So here, once you do, like here what I do is basically I just run that app jar, and I would base this on a particular previously built Docker image. So it's basically a JDK 8, and basically I build this image and then I can push it to my repository. And then from the repository I will fetch it from Akasa, and then I can run it on Akasa. So if I go to Akasa, one of the machines and check the images. So I have created this, I created two versions. One is version one and the other one is version two. So this image is now pushed to Akasa. Now we can actually do a deployment. So it's just gonna say hello world. So to do that, like I said, now with newer version of Docker, it actually runs on Docker Swarm mode, and you can basically create a service and give number of replicas that you want to run. So we have three physical nodes, one master, two two workers, and we can say, okay, I'm going to create a service called my app, which is having two replicas, and I'm going to publish port 80. And since my service is actually listening to port 8080, I'm going to redirect all port 80 to 8080, and this is my image I'm going to run. Right, so this should basically create two replicas of that Docker image, so or the microservice, right? So it goes and does that, and then we can see Docker service PS my right. So it actually created two containers, one in this particular node, which is not this one. It seems to be, yeah, this node, and the other one is in, other one is actually in this node. So the third node, you don't have anything running. And so the idea here is basically you have a desired state which is running. So it will basically, once you start, it will start and then initialize and all that, and then it should come to a running state, right? So now it's running for a while. Now we have three IP addresses. I don't think you can see it from here. You can't see it from here because it's an internal one, but I can show you from our deployment platform. So this is the Docker manager. And yeah, the first IP is something like this. So if you type that one, say hello, overlay network, it will automatically route to those two containers. So that's what it does. And if you want to expand it, if you want to increase this, you can basically scale it up. So you can say, okay, Docker service. Yeah, so we have my app with two containers. So you can say service scale my app to 10. So now it will start scaling. Now if you look at my app, yeah, there you go. So it started scaling up to about 10 containers, right? And similarly, you can do an upgrade without having a downtime. You can do a, like, this is version 1, you can do it to the version 2. Let's first scale it down to, say, about 3. So scaling down also happens similarly. Now if you see, these ones have been shut down and 3 of them are running. So it doesn't really matter where it runs. It can move around among those 3 nodes however they want. And if you want to update, you can do a service update. So let's say I have a new image. I have created the second version of it, so I want to update into the second version. Can do a Docker service update image version 2 my app. So then what it does is it will basically shut down now slowly, one by one it will update. So this method of upgradation, whether it's like you want to have a certain, give a little bit of time, say after 10 minutes, or have a some sort of parallelly you can upgrade multiple things, all that is configurable. So here I'm just one shot upgrade the whole thing. So they'll show you here. The first one has been gone down, and the version 2 has come up now. So likewise, the Docker itself, actually Docker project itself, now came up with this Swarm, which is pretty amazing with the whole orchestration bit as well. And it is, by the way, available on Nakas right now. So you can test it out and have a go at it. Okay. So, okay, continuing on. Yeah, these are some of the important, like the cheat sheet that you get with Docker. You can logs to look at the sort of standard output information, PS to look at all the running Docker containers and all that. Then you have the Swarm, and you have the services, things like scaling up, scaling down, doing some updates, and all that. Okay, Kubernetes. So basically, this does very similar to what Docker Swarm does, but this has been sort of tried and tested for last 15 years at Google. So this is much more matured product, and compared to maybe Docker Swarm, this is so this is much more production ready. So if you have a, maybe a smaller infrastructure and you want to test it out, maybe you can go with Swarm and you know slowly adopt Kubernetes however you like. So it has a very similar architecture. So the scheduling, the master, it has a master node and then bunch of slave nodes called mini, earlier used to call minions. And the master node has the REST service API where you can actually control it with Kubernetes control CLI or even some other API calls also you can use it. And the scheduling part and the replication controller and the configuration management. And then you have the concept of pod, which is a bit similar to what Docker Composer does. Basically, it's you can have multiple containers, but unlike Docker Composer, pods actually gives you a same namespace. So if you have two containers running inside a pod, they will share the same namespace. So if for, I don't know, if for some reason that you want to have that features, then pod would be an ideal scenario. And a Kubernetes proxy basically creates that very similar to the, basically expose the ports similar to what you do with the overlay network. Yeah, so the pod is basically the atomic unit of Kubernetes. And it's a self-contained and small group of containers. And the volumes, all that are tightly coupled and has the shared namespace. And the volumes, basically, very similar to Docker volumes. And you support multiple storage systems like the Ceph, the NFS, iSCSI, whole lot of things. And replication controller is basically, once you give a job to replication controller, it does one thing. Like you saw how it scaled up. When I say 10, it'll go and scale up. A very similar thing it does. It says, you know, it does a periodical check saying, you know, I have given it to have 10 pods. And if it is less than 10 pods, it'll try to bring up to 10 pods. If it is, more than 10 pods, it will start killing whatever the extra bit of pods that you have. So that is what the replication controller does. And you can have a labeling mechanism so that you can have, say, these are the devs, these are the production ones, these are the testing ones, these are the development or whatever. So you can, based on that, you can filter it. You have much more granular control with Kubernetes compared to Docker Swarm. And the services are very similar to what Docker Swarm services. It basically creates a virtual IP so that the client actually sees that virtual IP and can access all these containers behind it. And it hides all the complexity there. Okay. So let's have a look at the Kubernetes demo also. Okay. So you have a two ways to do it. Like I said, the if you look remember the first slide where you have multiple entry points for the REST API. So you have a, you actually have a nice GUI if you want to manage everything here, or you can do it at the command line. So similar to Docker Composer, you can create the whole deployment plan in a YML saying what exactly you are going to deploy. And here I'm just going to deploy a Nginx application. And if I show you what's so this is what Docker Compose configuration look like. So very similarly, you have very similar to that. You have a YML configuration for Kubernetes pods as well. So here, all you need to do is say kube control create minus f, and you can give the configuration file, and that should create the start the pods. So here I have actually created one master and about three nodes, I think. So kube control get deployments. Yeah, so I said two pods to be created. I think I would have mentioned two replicas here. Yeah. And then you can also see the get pods command to see what are the pods that are running. And if you want to expose this through proxy, we can just do a port forwarding. I'll just do a port forwarding and show you how you can access it. So I'm port forwarding and binding to the same port 80. So it should do It should do port forwarding. Just do a sudo there. Yeah. So like I said, you can have a external load balancer actually talking to these ones. So just to avoid that, I'll just create a SSH tunnel and. Create SSH channel so we can access it on port 555 localhost. So localhost port 555. Yeah. So you get that Nginx. So similarly, you can do the whole scaling things. You can basically bring it down, and all that things are there. So I'll quickly. Run through the CloudShed on Akasa. This is how we basically brought these Docker and Kubernetes to Akasa. And this is the Akasa's underhood. It's actually a Citrix Cloud platform where you have a fully-fledged business layer and the infrastructure layer. And you have billings and you have different integration APIs and all that. So we basically attack the virtualization layer. So we got the access to the virtualization layer, and our solution, CloudShed, the brokering solution, could directly talk to Akasa's virtualization layer and create all those instances that you have, which you saw. So it's basically a single solution that works with multiple, whether private or public clouds. And we have an established software catalog where you can just click and deploy. And the whole idea is to convert this into a self-servicing ICT. and you can do, you know, departmental billing and you know, application based, activity based billing as well. So if I just like in a nutshell, so we basically aggregate, simplify, and secure, and integrate different software as a service, PaaS, infrastructure as a service, and all that, and provide that to the end consumers via on-demand and self-servicing ITs, ICT, and all that. And just to show the system quickly, so we have a very simple dashboard where you, whatever you have deployed comes here, and then you can basically manage your application. Let's try to see whether we can deploy an extra node for our Docker cluster. So say Docker, let's see. So all you have to do is basically just give a name here. Say this is Docker node 03. And then you have a bunch of cloud providers that you can connect to. So we basically select, okay, Akasa 1GB instance, and then deploy. That's it. That's all you have to do. And once it is deployed, it will show you basically similar application management dashboard. In the application management dashboard, let's say I created it as a project. So similar to this, you can basically get the remote access details, and even you can basically remote from here itself. Even if you have a Windows server or whatever, you can actually remote it here. So one of the things that we have looked at is like not everywhere you have like fully fledged containers. You might have physical machines, you might have virtual machines, and then you have containers. So you'll have this whole heterogeneous environment, which is actually supported with Akasa, so we can actually connect it there and have your whole infrastructure, having a like a hybrid infrastructure with of your organization, and then you know, doing some cloud bursting or extending into the cloud through this system as well. So let's see if it is not deployed. Yeah, it's still deploying. So basically, the other advantage is like if you decided to go to bare metal, let's say you are deploying all these containers in the virtual environment, and you decided to go to bare metal, you can still do it without you know, disrupting the existing users. So, okay, so I think that's it on my end. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Okay then, thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Vikramasinghe. Next, I'd like to invite our next speaker, Mr. Ashan Fernando. He's AWS Solutions Architect at 99x Technology, and he'll be talking on microservices without servers.
So until the presentation is set up, let me try to build a story. So we have been into microservices almost a year before, and through our journey, we have found different technologies take the hype in different time periods. So today, I'm going to talk about key aspect of microservices and key platform where you can build microservices in a different way, so things are more simpler than it's complex. So let me try to start with the presentation. So when it comes to microservices, or always, let's say, the applications, it's always difficult to manage the servers. So I think all the experienced guys here, you know the difficulty. And when it comes to microservices, you know, it's not only a single server. It's basically multiple virtualized environments or virtualized containers which you have to manage. And that can become really cumbersome over time. Although there's a lot of monitoring and other platforms out there, but it can become challenging. So I'm today going to present a solution which can help you to rethink of your design and so on. So as you all know, managing a service is quite difficult. You need to do the software updates. You need to do different things in the operating system level. And you need to update your, like, do and put extra effort to handle failures and so on. Although, even if you take a virtual machine in cloud, let's say, for instance, EC2 instance in AWS, still you have to do certain aspects of it. Like, you have to do certain, you have certain operational overhead. And when it comes to microservices, as I mentioned, it's quite difficult, even difficult. And just think for a moment, what if you can build microservices without servers and forgetting about how you scale up, how you provision things, and how you do these things quite easily, and also improving the developer productivity. That's a very important area, because when we talk about microservices, we talk about multifunctional teams where we have full-stack developers and who knows about how to manage and deploy these things. But in reality, not all of us are capable of doing each of these parts. So we need different platforms or cloud providers to manage certain aspects of these things. So let me introduce how to build serverless microservices. So when we think about microservices or our applications, we used to think in a way that we need a place to host the application. Am I right? That's the common norm here. And when we think about microservices without servers, the cloud providers today, especially the Amazon Cloud leading the game, they have came up with a concept called cloud native services. And now it's available in almost all the cloud platforms, where you can use a very specific set of services to build your application. And in AWS, you can separate the computation, the part of your basically where you put your logic, programming logic, in a single service called Lambda. And you can use API Gateway, again, a service fully managed by the cloud provider, to host your API, and so on. So moving forward, so in AWS, one of the power behind microservices came up with the service called AWS Lambda. Just think for a moment, even with when you have a microservices platform, or let's say a set of microservices, you have to have certain middleware, even like Docker Swarm, because you have to, you can expect failures. You need to monitor things. Because why do you need to monitor things? Because things are running all the time. Just think for a moment, you have a server which is not running. And when the user or a consumer want to use the service, let's say they hit a URL, the service starts up and sends the reply, and it shuts down. Just think for a moment. Then do you get the problem of managing these services? Because that's not there. So it's a quite innovative service, which AWS introduced quite a few years back, where you can write code, write logic for microservices, where it can be triggered from events. So in this example, you can use API Gateway, which is, of course, a running service, and which is managed, so failure and all the things are managed by AWS. It's not our problem. And use that service to trigger Lambda. So your code runs only when it needs to be executed. And what is the catch? So there are a lot of important things here. One thing is the cost. AWS doesn't cost you unless you write your code, unless the code is running. So that's a very important thing. Because if you think about APIs and versioning, you need to keep multiple versions running, right? I think we all agree on that. But who's going to pay for those? Probably we, because we need to keep certain things running. And we have to have at least a minimum footprint to keep these things running. But when it comes to Lambda, you can keep different versions of microservices deployed, but you don't pay unless it's used. So that's kind of a very high advantage when using Lambda. And currently, it supports a couple of technologies like Java, Node.js, and Python. So you can just write your code, focus on writing your code, wire things up, and then build a microservice. So that's the focus here. So what AWS tries to do here is to kind of reduce the complexity in building microservices and keep making it open for everyone to start with building these. So let's have a very quick look at, I have a couple of screenshots from the AWS console, web console. So this is the console for, this is the part of the console for API Gateway, where you can see in the corner, you can declare your REST API, and you can see a flow where at the end of the flow, you define a Lambda function. So it's very basic flow. You have the API definition. Of course, you can use Swagger if you want to code it. And you have at the end, you have the Lambda. And this is a very basic flow of request and response. And this is the Lambda console. And you can see, you can select the runtime, Node.js, and you can select the, if you have Java, you can in the dropdown, you can select Java and or Python. And then you can write the code here. So just think about it. Do you want to really write the code here? I don't think so. You will get killed by your developers because it's not you developers. They don't want to write code in the web browser, at least for now. So this is a problem at the beginning, or at least in the beginning we had to write our code in an editor and then zip it and upload it here. You have the second option, but still it's not the best way of developing application, right? I think we all agree on that also. So that problem was a challenge over a year now. And finally, there was a framework which is developed called serverless. Have anyone, can you raise your hand if you have heard the word called serverless? So probably very few. But this is a very kind of, it's a basically hype because one of the most challenging building microservices was how to do the DevOps and also how to get it closer to the developer. So that gap was kind of fixed by this framework. This is not a kind of a silver bullet. What it does is you can have a traditional way of keeping your code in a single repository, and you can create individual folders for your microservices, and rest of the provisioning part and also deployment and everything, the DevOps parts will be handled by the frameworks with a very handful of commands. So that's the wonderful part of it. And you can browse the URL serverless.com later and go inside. You will get a lot of boilerplates to start it directly. So it's out there. And of course, it's good if you can also contribute to this project. It's an open source project. And now I'm going to go into the experience that I'm going to share the experience that we have with serverless microservices development. So to give you a very brief about a particular project that we did. So we had to build, we wanted to build our backend as microservices with Node.js and the front-end application using Angular. Probably you know about it. And also, we need to have a web application with a hybrid web application that can run on multiple mobile devices. And of course, this is a choice using DynamoDB for the database. So the part of the screen is capped. Let me. Okay, there's a part that is not visible in here, but let me directly try to explain. So I was listing three sections basically. One is for the web app, the second part was for the microservices, or let's say the microservices with Lambda and API Gateway, and the third part was for Docker. But the Docker part is somehow hidden, maybe because we had a session before. I don't know. So for the moment, just think about building these microservices with these cloud-native service offerings. So the difference is, rather you try to build the entire service as a whole, you try to break it even to different places, and these individual things are managed by the cloud. For instance, when you want to, for instance, the code you can deploy in Lambda. the API offering, the opening of the API, you can host in the API gateway and wire them up. And also, if you need file storage, you can take a managed file storage like S3, where you can even host your web application. So those things are there. So the idea here is you can use set of cloud native services to assemble your application or your microservices. So that's the important thing here. Oops, again, the image is not there, but let me try to use the previous image. The first part I want to explain was the top part, where you can host the entire Angular app in a place called a S3 bucket. And the second part, of course, you can see here, but not in the second line in here. The second part is the microservice deployment. So I will directly skip to the next slide, because it's not visible somehow. Oops. So when it comes to manage microservices, like when I was talking about microservices without servers, at least for now. But there are certain challenges when building event-driven using event-driven computation for microservices, which has the problem in the concept itself. So when you have an event-driven computation, you need to allocate or provision the computation containers at the time being, on demand. So always, just you can understand, when that happens, you can't have very large workloads to be directly loaded and executed, because it has its own lifetime. So that's a challenge with Lambda. So for in our case, we wanted to have, this is the experience we had, we wanted to have a screen capturing service. For example, when you type the URL of a website, the microservice should be able to take a screenshot and store it in S3 and give us a URL. So that's a very simple task that the service should do. But that service doesn't fit with Lambda, because to do that, you need a headless browser. And those browsers has kind of its own libraries and its own overhead. So Lambda doesn't suit that, because if you use Lambda, all the time when you put the URL, Lambda needs to load those code for the browser and then execute it, and then return the result, which takes more time, because the loading part takes more time than the capturing of the web page. So there are certain things Lambda doesn't suit for. So for that, and another thing is, since these things are happening on the fly, event-driven, when the Lambda executes with events, there is something called call start and the host start. So what is call start? Let's say you hit a URL on the browser, and the service, the Lambda was not running for 5 minutes or so. The Lambda will be started on the fly, and it takes around a couple of seconds to start the Lambda service. But it, again, seconds. In a web application environment, you don't need, you have to get the request at least in a single second. So in there, you get around 5 to 10 seconds. So that's too much. But there's a solution as well. When Lambda execute one time, it will keep it for 5 minutes. So in between, it can serve the other request. And what about the scalability? It will manage the scalability. So it's not our problem anymore. We just have to define the memory, and it will scale horizontally without our intervention. And here we have to live with Docker, because for the particular problem I mentioned, to capture a web page, we had to stick with Docker. And of course, there are a lot of challenges with that. But still, currently, Lambda is not at that level, handling catering all type of microservices. And if I ask the question again, what are the types of things that you can do with Lambda? Of course, you can start your microservice development with Lambda. It's very easy, and the footprint is minimal. You can start it even using the serverless framework I mentioned. You can just download it, create an Amazon account, you can just start coding. So that's the level that it has gone to. So it just takes probably 5 to 10 minutes to understand and start and host your API. So that's fast. And of course, you have to have some cloud knowledge. That's part of it. And I went through the slides quite fast. And hopefully, I hope like you will get, I will get a lot of questions in this this area. And good luck with microservices and all the best. Thank you.
We will now have the Q&A session. So I'd like to invite all our three speakers onto the stage.
A practical question, I guess, maybe to Afkam. I'm Channa Gunawardena. So basically, I use the Visual Studio and .NET development environment, and typically you have to add a service reference. So if you're using WCF, you'd add a single service reference. With microservices, how does it work? I mean, do you add services service references in your client app for all of the microservices?
So there are a number of ways in which you can do. Typically, like you will have something called a service registry. So like you can have a discovery phase where you basically like you, within your client. So here I think you are talking about a service talking to another service. So then in that instance, it becomes a client, right? You could look up this registry. You on like when you code, when you write your code, you basically have a key. You look up that key and you get the actual endpoint from the runtime. So that's one way of doing it. And in environments like Kubernetes and Docker and so on, you can pass environment variables. So when you are booting up a particular container, you can pass those particular endpoints as environment variables, and the runtime will basically like read those variables, and basically that will be the client endpoint. So there are a bunch of, no, it's like standard service discovery mechanism. You have anything to add there?
I think, yeah, just to add that, I think things like Zookeeper, etcd, Consul, some of the VCAP services and all that, where you can actually get those, let's say you are running, you are labeling it as a production, right? So that particular pod is on a production environment, so it will fetch all the production database details and things like that from those service discovery registries. Yeah.
Hi, so let's say that we are building an API as a composition of multiple microservices. So in that case, say for example, from one microservice, we need to communicate with another microservice. So what's the best method? Like, is it through the HTTP interface, I mean the API interface itself, or having a message by bus kind of thing for inter-microservice communications? What would be the best option?
Okay. I guess there's no silver bullet as such. So depending on your requirement, whether you could use a queue, like you said, you could use a queue, or things like Docker provides that binding. The linking facility, what it actually does is basically it passes all the environmental variables from the previous container to the one that is getting bounded. So that's a one way, and then you can have the service discovery mechanism. And with pods, you actually have a shared shared namespace. So you could even use IPCs like inter-process communications. You can actually, if it is a within a pod, you can use. But if it is like two different containers, you can't use it. So really, it will depend on your requirement. There'll be many sort of solutions.
If you take conceptually, it should be through the interface. Because when you build microservices separately, if you couple the code or have dependencies within each other, you don't get the benefit of isolation. So I believe it should be through the interface. So even though you share certain things, it should go through the API interface.
If you remember my inner architecture and outer architecture diagram, there's a gateway which is external facing. So you have to separate your external facing API. So you will have your you might have your microservices architecture within your business, but you need to expose APIs to other organizations.
So you have to think of those APIs as separate, right? So with, so you will have internal APIs for your microservices to communicate with each other, and there will be external APIs which are for external parties, mobile clients, you know, other B2B integration you know, facilities. So like for those type of things, so you have two different APIs. So you need to separate those aspects.
Hi. How do you manage versions from regarding microservices in a environment? I mean, how do you make sure that there is no like different incompatible versions talking to incompatible versions, basically?
Okay. So one of the things that we would do that if you have a let's say REST API or something. We could actually like prefix it with a, like say version 1, version 2 and all that. And then maybe you might have like some of the containers actually running on version 1 and some of the containers running on version 2 also. And then slowly, you know, like if you are migrating into version 2, you can slowly migrate out because maybe your front end is not ready with fully ready with version 2. You might be also testing it out, right? So so I think that's one way of slowly migrating it out. But I think the whole, in the whole scenario that you wouldn't have a downtime. So you could have both the versions. Let's say by mistake you put something wrong with your version 2, you could just simply take it out as well. So and also when you are like updating the version, you could have a strategy where you upgrade like say 50% of the containers first and then slowly migrate the rest of it. So there are a few ways that you can do it.
Yeah. Does that answer your question? Any other questions?
Just add to that question, in our scenario, because we are practically using this microservices with Spring Boot and Protocol Buffer and gRPC. So gRP Protocol Buffer, Google Protocol Buffer has inbuilt support for API versioning where we can keep backward compatibility. So if you are using protocol buffer with gRPC or another remoting procedure, I think we can resolve it very easily.
As Afkam said, it's more of a buzzword today. But how would the ERPs should adapt sort of ERP architecture, sort of more of sort of a ESB type of environments, which are more traditional, more enterprise scale. How are they going to adapt to microservices, if at all, if it is possible?
So you are talking about the actual ERP software. So it's the software itself, the system has to support
more of the enterprise architectures.
Yeah.
For example, you know, ESB based enterprise architectures, ELP systems.
So what's happening currently is like more and more like systems are moving towards this containerized world, right? So what I feel is like eventually like those systems will evolve to support. So like of course there will no still be this traditional monolithic systems lying around, but like the approach is actually like to take bits of the application out and basically introduce microservices. So rather than doing a big bang change to the architecture, what typically happens is, like I said, eating the monolith one bit at a time. So you look at certain aspects, like whether you can
take the identity management component out and then scale it out as microservices, container instances, whether you can take the user management aspects, right? So stuff like that. So what I feel is that's what would happen. Like they would like eventually like move to a full MSA, but for the time being, they would start adopting like best practices, right? So adopt certain things as microservices. Like even like you could like in systems like Kubernetes, you don't have, so if you are adopting that, you don't have to have everything as containers. Like there is this concept of you can register like talk to external services and endpoints, right? So you could still have your legacy identity management system or your LDAP, which is, you know, integrate which appears as an endpoint to your services. So that's in a way in which like you could like have a hybrid sort of setup. So I think initially that's what it would like be, and then systems would eventually evolve.
Yeah, actually we have a very good example because we have a legacy application, core insurance application, which is about like 16 years old, running on Oracle forms, like it's rock solid, but it does, you cannot introduce any new features. So what we are doing is we are introducing a, like a microservice layer. Let's say, you know, at the moment it may have like a claim, you know, like a claim intimation system, but we want to do a, like a claim processing system where people will have their, use their mobiles and take pictures real time. They would talk to the agent through WebRTC or whatever. But you cannot do none of those with Oracle forms and all that. So we create that layer in microservices. So slowly, slowly, we are addressing the business needs. So that will give an edge in the industry. So because CoE is running well, so let it be. Slowly we will move it out, but at the moment we are creating all the business value to the those legacy applications.
Yeah. I can also share some experience we had recently. We had this risk management application which was developed using Ruby on Rails and in the early versions of Ruby on Rails. And as you all know, moving from Ruby on Rails early versions to the upper versions is difficult because it's not backward compatible. So there was a point where we have to decide whether to rewrite the application, of course it is not possible, and or either we have to migrate part by part. So the choice was, first the application was developed as an API and a front end using Backbone JS and Ruby on Rails. So first step was to have a gateway to kind of in front of the API, so all the requests are routed at the same API, and then gradually part by part we were able to move to Docker. So that's a practical example, like we could easily do it, but the difficult part is containerizing the first part of the application. That will be the always the challenge, but the next part, introducing microservices, is not the challenge because you can write new code there. So it's, you don't have to depend on Ruby or any other language you used in the main monolith platform.
In the case of the serverless architecture, like say if it's like an application which consists of so many services like Lambda and the event driven services, how do you kind of isolate each application to one another when you after you deploy it?
So what do you mean by each application, if you can explain?
So like one Lambda is just one computer, right?
Yeah.
So there might be another application which will have another Lambda, a totally different application. But like we'll have multiple of applications. So like one application would be owned by one company, another one by another company. Yeah. From a kind of a security perspective or some kind of a isolation perspective, how would you...
Yeah, when we take Lambda, it's an isolated environment, isolated container environment, which is managed by AWS. So when you put the code in Lambda, then it will be provisioned at least let's say, which we don't know how they provision the infrastructure, but they guarantee that it's isolated. And the placement also isolated, like, it's not, it's also a part of the microservice, because you have to define certain parts in the API gateway, where how you link, wire it up. So the container placement is isolated by the Amazon Web Services. At least they guarantee it at the moment. Did I answer the question?
But can it be proven, or how would you, I mean, how would they kind of prove that?
At the moment, we just have to be with the their compliance. So that's it for the moment.
I think if there are any more questions, you all can speak to the speakers afterwards. So one more reminder, if you all have any questions regarding the cloud platform, you all can speak to any representative from Sri Lanka Telecom. Also, in closing, I'd like to thank, on behalf of Slashcom, I'd like to thank our three speakers, Mr. Afkam Aziz, Mr. Janaka Vikramasinghe, and Mr. Ashan Fernando. And also want to thank Sri Lanka Telecom for organizing this event. And last but not least, thank you to all the participants who attended, and also be in touch to know about the future events. And thank you once again, and hope you have a wonderful evening.